Well, good morning, Canyon Springs. Would you stand with me, please? And welcome our Facebook friends and brothers and sisters in Christ for worshiping with us this morning. He keeps me singing, and that's what the Lord does for us.
Amen.
When we think about our salvation, we want to sing about it. If you want to turn in your hymnal, when we all get to heaven, something we're looking forward to. And greet your neighbor, tell them how you missed them. seated.
All right, amen. All right, Wade, what a blessing, what great singing. I want to welcome you here to Canyon Springs Baptist Church. Thank you for visiting with us and being a part of our family today. There's a card in front of you there. It's a connection card, a prayer card. Maybe you want to fill that out. You can give that to one of our men in the back, or go ahead and put that in the offering box out front there. We want to just be an encouragement and a help to you, and we're so thankful that you're here this morning with us as we worship the Lord together. So what's happening in the life and ministry here at Canyon Springs? We've got several things going on. I want to make mention of those. This week, we have our patio sale this week, and it's kind of a big thing. We're striving to have a opportunity to meet our friends and our family and those in our community. We'd love for you to be a part of that. I saw many of you already bringing your items that you're donating, and you can bring them right over to the fellowship hall. There's some tables there, corner there, just anywhere that you could get those in there. That would be fantastic. We're going to try to be setting up on Thursday. That's the 9th. So if you could come out maybe Thursday morning at 8 a.m. and help set up for our sale. A couple years ago, I think we were done by noon and getting all the stuff out of the storages, all the tables set up, all the things out on the tables and so on and so forth. So that would be fantastic. You say, preacher, hey, I got a nice chair or I got a little couch or love seat, but I don't have any way to get it here. Just let me know. And I know that we have several men in our church that have trucks or would be willing to come over and grab that from you. Just let me know so we can schedule that, if that would be a help to you. I know that we'd want to make sure that we have all sorts of resources here to help out. So if you brought your soda in, appreciate that. We brought your hot dog, your bun-length hot dog. That's a great thing. I know I saw several throwing their bun-length hot dogs in the fridges over there and their sodas and all of that. So we do appreciate that. So that's kind of what's going on here. And we're going to have lots of opportunities to minister. So you say, Pastor, what can I do? Well, you could come and meet somebody. You could come and maybe help out with some of the sorting. Maybe some of you ladies are really good at folding clothes. You know, we always got clothes in bags, and so the folding needs to happen. And then maybe you can organize some things a little bit and help so people can see what's there. There's always opportunities for good fellowship. It's going to be a great week this week. So you come and you hang out with us and you get to know each other. We're going to have a table where we have some church invitations and some information there. And so you can maybe invite someone to come to church with you on Sunday and sit with you and be your friend at church. That would be a great, great opportunity this weekend. So opportunities are everywhere, and we want to make mention of that. Of course, we do have our ladies' Bible study and our men's coffee hour. We schedule that every week. I forgot to ask, are we still doing that on Thursday? I think for the Friday men, we're going to have the for sure Friday. There's going to be no coffee hour. We'll be working, and so there'll be no men's coffee hour this Friday. And we'll let you know, ladies, on the Facebook if we want how that all comes. I didn't even think about that this week because I know that we're working very hard over there, and all the things are kind of everywhere. So we'll be talking about that just a little bit. Okay, what else we got here? We've got our opportunities to give. You guys have been doing a great job at giving. Different opportunities you can give online. You can give in the box out there, or you can just mail that in. And you guys are doing a fantastic job. If you have any questions about those, please just let us know. We'd love to be able to answer any of those questions that you may have regarding that. So we do need some help. Maybe working in the concession stand there. I need someone to maybe grill the hot dogs. Maybe you're the grill master. Let me know. We need someone to do that on Friday and Saturday. Maybe you can have us. Now, only requirement is that you are happy about it. There's nothing like a hot dog with a smile. Amen. Rather than a hot dog with a frown. Now, if you're really hungry, I guess it doesn't matter, right? But we want to do a good job of representing the Lord Jesus here, okay? So all sorts of opportunities, and we'll be letting you know more about that. Let's continue to sing together. Let's stand together as we sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Seated.
All right. All right. I'd like to read some scripture this morning. We'll have a word of prayer. We'll have a special. Then we'll dive in to the message. If you'd like to follow along with me, that would be fantastic. Ephesians chapter 6. And we're going to read verse number 10 and verse 11. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Notice verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now let's go over to 2 Timothy. So you're going to go to the right in your Bible, the book of 2 Timothy, chapter number 1. The point being, we are in a battle, spiritual battle. 2 Timothy, chapter number 1. Notice verse 7, please. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. Let's ask the Lord to bless the scripture. Lord Jesus, we love you, and we just ask you, Lord, as we're meeting together today, that you would help us to focus, to center our mind, center our heart. Lord, lots of activities have happened already. The singing was amazing, Lord, and the fellowship of your people have been encouraging. And I just ask, Lord, that as the Word of God goes forward here, that this message would be a source of encouragement, a source of strength, and a source of help. As in our lives, there's battles. There's physical battles and spiritual battles. And Lord, we're asking you, Lord, to help us be courageous in them. Lord, you've not given us that spirit of fear. Lord, that's not from you. And we ask, Lord, that as we open up your word, that you would concentrate our heart on you. And Lord, may we apply these principles in such a way that we'd be different and changed. Bless the remainder of our service, Lord, and the message to follow in your name. Amen.
There are moments on our journey following the Lord when God illumines every step we take. There are times when circumstances make perfect sense to us as we try to understand each move He makes. But when the path grows dim and our questions have no answers, turn to Him, bow the knee. Trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of His plan, in the presence of your King, bow the knee. There are days when clouds surround us and the rain begins to fall, and the cold and lonely winds won't cease to blow. And there seems to be no reason for the suffering we feel. We are tempted to believe God does not know. But when the storms arise, don't forget we live by faith and not by sight. Bow the knee, trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of His plan, in the presence of your King, bow the knee. And when you don't understand the purpose of His plan, in the presence of your King, bow the knee.
I'd like you to turn in your Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 13, all the way in the Old Testament there. And of course, if you found Second Samuel, you want to go just to the left there a little bit and go to 1 Samuel chapter 13. Just give me a little monitor, just a small amount there, Hudson, on my microphone, please. Thank you. All right, that's good. Boy, this is one of those messages that's interesting. You know, the Lord is kind of, you know, sometimes He gives you these messages or these principles, and they really speak to you, and they speak to me, and I think I'm confident that these will be helpful today to you, but I recognize we're many of us are at different places in life, right? Different struggles. If I say to you, you know, what was the most frustrating thing that happened to you last week? Some of you would say, well, you know, I had to wait in line. You know, that was frustrating. Or some of you would say, well, I got a phone call and it wasn't very good. You know, so I understand that our struggles sometimes are a little bit different. So when you try to apply the scripture, this is the working of the Holy Spirit. The working of the Holy Spirit is if the Lord lives in you and resides in you, God can use His word, work it in your life, and you can apply it to your life in a very special way. I think it's good for you to get in the habit of applying scripture. There's principles that we're going to talk about. Maybe you're not in need of what I'm going to say today, or maybe it just goes over your head, or maybe it doesn't just, you know, zing right what you're asking the Lord for today as you've come in. Let me just encourage you to ponder these things, because there might be a day and a time where you're going to need these truths in different areas. We read earlier about what Paul said to the book church there at Ephesus about how we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Paul knew we were in a spiritual battle. And we had an enemy. Peter says that we have there's a roaring lion. Satan is a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. But God has not given us, according to what Paul says, the spirit of fear, right? And so we find ourselves here in 1 Samuel, chapter number 13. The context here is Samuel has anointed Saul to be king. He is king now for several years. And it was Israel's desire that they have a king so that the king would go and out to battle with them and organize them in such a way as an army so they would go and battle the Philistines and the Amorites and all the enemies of the Lord. They've got a king. His name is Saul. So the early parts of the first book of 1 Samuel are about Samuel himself and about this transition from God being over Israel to God has installed these kings. Samuel, or Saul, was the first one. This was a difficult time. The situation was very dire. It was a bad situation. If you're there in chapter 13, let me just express to you the beginning of this bad situation. Chapter 13 there, look with me at verse 19, please. The Bible says, "Now there was no smith found throughout all the land of Israel, for the Philistines said, lest the Hebrew make them swords or spears." So part of the enemy's attack was, you know what? We are going to go ahead and kill and remove every smith or every blacksmith or everyone that works with metal that can make a sword. We're going to remove that. We're going to remove all of that technology that they've had before. We're going to get rid of that so that we will have more swords and weapons than them. And you can see how that would propagate victory for the Philistines, right? Remove their weapons, they can't what? And so this was the Philistines having oppression over the nation of Israel. And they couldn't have, they didn't have any metal swords. They didn't have the modern weapons, if you will, of warfare at that time, because there was no smith, because they got rid of all the swords in Israel. They got rid of all the swords except for, look at verse 22 here of chapter 13. So it came to pass in the day of battle that there was neither sword nor spear found in the hand of any of the people that were with Saul and Jonathan. But with Saul and with Jonathan, his son, was there found. And so what we have here is a really, really sad event here. There was no one to make swords, no weapons here, but all of the men that came to fight, there was no swords for them. And all of Israel, according to what the Bible says, how many swords were in all of Israel? I counted two. I'm smart. I can count to two. I can count that high. Don't ask me to go much higher. But there was only two swords in all of Israel at this time. Saul is king. He has a sword. His son Jonathan has a sword. And that's it. And everybody else that follows them probably has different kinds of weapons. Maybe some slings and maybe some wooden spears or whatever. But there are no swords. There's no smith to be found. The Philistines operated their plan to a T. And by the way, it takes time for that plan to go forward. And boy, you know, let me just give just a small amount here. This is why it's important here that we don't let people take away our ability to defend ourselves or to have weapons. Amen. So you say, what, are you a warmonger? No, I just want to make sure I can protect myself. Amen? Amen. Amen. Trust me. The government says, trust me. No. No, I trust me. Amen. I trust the Lord. So here they are in our text here. There is a bad situation. King Saul is there and they're in Gibeah and they have about 600 men. Look at what it says here in verse 2 of chapter 14. And Saul tarried in the uttermost part of Gibeon under the pomegranate tree, which is in Migron, and the people were with him were about 600 men. And so Saul was there. He had 600 men, and they were surrounded by the enemy. As we go on, we'll see that all the Philistines were all around. They had garrisons, which is like an outpost of their main army. They had garrisons so that they could find out where the people are. And they were getting ready. And Saul and 600 men were really, if you will, they were surrounded. This is what they were. They were surrounded. Now, I don't know about you, but that sounds pretty bad. You're surrounded by an enemy and you have... That's to me, it doesn't look good. Surrounded by the enemy, they all have swords, and you don't have any, but two, Saul and Jonathan. Now look at chapter 14 here. Go to verse 23. This is the end of the story. I love stories. The beginning of the story is we have no swords, we have two swords. We're surrounded. This doesn't look very good. Look at verse 23. So the Lord saved Israel that day, and the battle passed over unto Beth-Aven. So the beginning was pretty dire, and the ending, the Lord gave the victory. The Lord gave that victory. And we say, man, that is amazing what the Lord did. And how did he do it? There was two swords. How did he do it? I submit to you, sometimes we want the victory in life. We want God to do something in our life. And we look at situations as dire and destitute. And we don't know how God can do work through these things. But guess what? He surely can. And by the way, it was because of Jonathan, Saul's son here, that all of this change happened. This incredible victory took place, and it was initiated by courage and valor of one man that had a sword, and it wasn't King Saul. It was Jonathan. Jonathan is probably this passage of scripture. And this story of Jonathan and his courage is right up there with me. I mean, I love Caleb. I mean, he was 85 years. We read about it a couple weeks ago. 85 years old, and he was still as strong as he was the day that he went into Kadesh Barnea and spied out the land, and where he says we're well able to take it. He had to wait a little bit, but guess what? He got that mountain. And he was faithful, and he is courageous, and he actually did it. And man, what a great story. The Bible says about Caleb that he wholly followed the Lord his God. I mean, it was a heart issue. It was a heart issue. So this is a victory that we're going to read about, that we're going to study, that we're going to think about. Sometimes our life starts out so bleak, we have two swords against how many? The question is this, not how many swords do you have, but do you desire to live a life where, you know what, God is going to get that victory? Do you desire to win some battles against some enemies in your life? You say, what are you talking about? You got some enemies in life. You are in a spiritual battle right now. I mean, discouragement will come. Heartache will come. Oppression will come. And you've got some spiritual battles that you're dealing with. Let me ask you, do you want the victory? Do you want God to get that victory? I think every believer can win and can do it courageously, and you can win these battles for God. I think you can do it. I think there's some truth here with Jonathan as we look at him as a character study. We think about, wow, look what Jonathan did. One man's courage sparked a victory for all of Israel. God blessed his effort, if you will. If you look at verse number 6, I want you to notice here, Jonathan. The Bible says that Jonathan said unto the young man that bare his armor, come. We're in chapter 14, verse 6. It says, come, and let us go over under the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us. For there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few. Now, this speaks to me about trust. Jonathan is there. Saul, his father, and 600 men are hanging out in the backside of Gibeah, hiding out basically, underneath a pomegranate tree, waiting this thing out. Philistines are everywhere. And Jonathan says, hey, come up with me. Let's go. I'm done sitting here. I'm done playing it safe. I'm done. I want to go. I want to battle. I want to trust God for something. And he says right there, for the Lord is able to save by many or by few. And so guess what he was doing? He was trusting God. He says, God can save by many. You got a big army? You got lots of swords? You got lots of chariots? God could save light that way. God could save by one sword. He could do it by many, or he could do it by few. Jonathan was probably tired of sitting around. You ever get like that? I'm done just kind of treading water. I want to swim a little bit. I want to make some laps. I want to make some traction. I want to go do something. I'm tired of just waiting and living in this defeat. Jonathan says, these guys don't want to go do anything. Let's go fight some Philistines. Because God can do it. He can save by many or he can save by few. In this case, few is two people. Jonathan and his young man, we call him the armor bearer. We don't know his name. He's not given a name, but he is, I submit to you, very, very important. And he says, if it may be. So what was Jonathan doing? He was trusting God for what some would say is the impossible. You remember that passage of scripture in the book of Matthew where Jesus is talking and he's saying, all things are possible with God. You remember that? Some men say, but all things are possible. Here was Jonathan saying to his armor bearer, all things are possible. And you know what the world tells us? And you know what everybody else wants us to think? That everything that God is asking us to do, every victory, every battle that he wants us to wage, everything, all the courage that he's desiring from us is just, that's impossible. That's too hard. That's impossible. Well, we know that with God, all things are possible. Jonathan here trusted the Lord for the impossible. You know, I'm reminded in Scripture how much the Lord has a desire to use insignificant people to do very significant and what other people say is impossible. God loves using them. We got to ask ourselves, what are some of the things in our life that we think is impossible? Do you trust God that he can work those things out? Do you trust God that he'll meet your need? Do you trust God that he'll see you through? Obviously, Jonathan, if you know the end of the story, he had a victory. But obviously, it wasn't impossible. Now, everybody probably thought it was crazy. In fact, Jonathan even says in verse 6, it may be. That must have been pretty comforting to the armor bearer. So you want to go up there and you want to fight the Philistines. Just you and me, right? Yeah, just you and me. And it may be that the Lord will give us victory. Maybe not. Are you sure about this? I'm sure this armor bearer, but the armor bearer says something very amazing. Notice what he says in verse 7. And his armor bearer said unto him, do all that is in thine heart. Turn thee, behold, I am with thee according to thy heart. Boy, what a blessing. Hey, you know what? Let me tell you how important trusting the Lord is in our daily battles. Because it's going to look like it did in the beginning of the story. It's going to look like all we got is two swords. What are they among so many? I'm reminded of Jesus feeding the 5,000 with a little boy's lunch. What are these among so many? But at the end of it, there's 12 baskets filled and extra, right? Trust God for the impossible. Maybe there's some things in your life now that you just don't know what God's going to do. You just trust the Lord about it. Oh, we could fret. We could try to manipulate. We could try to do all that. But sometimes we got to remember that we serve a big God. A powerful God. A God that has all things under his control. And maybe we just have to learn to trust him to do some of these things that are impossible. Now, what does that require? I'm going to talk to you about something hard here. It requires that you leave a place of safety. Winning battles, spiritual battles, life battles, relationship battles, marriage battles. It requires that you have a little trust. But that trust should be leading you to some outward action. Don't be the guy that just talks about it all the time. Actually, go out there and leave your place of safety. Chapter 14, look at verse 1. Now it came to pass upon the day that Jonathan the son of Saul said unto the young man that bare his armor, come and let us go up to the Philistines' garrison that is on the other side. But he told not his father. Hey, sometimes it's time for you to get out and leave your place of safety. Look at verse number 4 with me. Now, this is where Jonathan was going. Him and his armor bearer. Look at verse 4. And between the passages by which Jonathan sought to go up unto the Philistines' garrison, there was a sharp rock on the one side and a sharp rock on the other side. And the name of the one was Bozez, and the name of the other was Sini. Now, this was a place where there's a sharp rock on this side and a sharp rock on that side, and we have to go up there. Verse 5, the forefront of the one was situated northward against Michmash, and the other southward against Gibeah. So this was close to the battle here. And he had to go. He had to go from the place of safety. He could have been sitting under the pomegranate tree like his father did. But Jonathan went. He left that place of safety. Now, here, let me give you a truth here. Don't think with me. We all have what we like to call our comfort zones. How many of you know what I'm talking about when I say that? We have a comfort zone. I could talk to these people, but not those people. I could do these things, but not that. I'm used to this, but not that. Don't get me into new situations. Don't know me, you know. So we all have our comfort zones. I submit to you, though, spiritual battles, physical battles maybe, they're not typically won without a risk. They're not typically won unless you get out of your comfort zone. See, battles are won on the front lines. Battles are won where the bullets are flying. Battles are won where when the going gets tough, the tough get going. Let me ask you this spiritually. Is there something God wants you to do? Maybe you need to get out of your comfort zone. You want some spiritual battles. You want some victories. You want God to do a great work. And yeah, you know, life seems kind of bleak. We got two swords. We got, this is all I got. This is who I am. But you know what? It's time for you maybe to step out on faith. Maybe to step out of your comfort zone so that you can do what God is asking you to do. I love the people that say, well, I haven't been called to that. Now, guess what? There are certain things that not everyone is called to. But there's things that all of us are called to. All of us are called to be a witness, to be a light, to be a giver, to be an encourager, to help one another person. But you got to step out of your comfort zone. You got to leave that place that's a place of safety, and you got to go out there. It's a courageous act. Be courageous. Cowards, you know what they do? They sit. Courageous people act. You want to courageously win some battles? You got to be willing to leave that place of safety. And Jonathan was willing. They were all there. And it says, you know what? I got everybody. Hey, I've got to go and battle. I've got to go do what God is asking me to do. Look at verse 7 with me. Here's this armor bearer. And his armor bearer said unto him, do all that is in thine heart. Turn thee, behold, I am with thee according to thy heart. So this armor bearer knew exactly what was in the heart of Jonathan. Now, you want to be successful, you want to courageously enter these battles that we're going to have in your life, your marriage, your family, your job situations. You got to trust the Lord about it. God could do the impossible. You might have to step out on faith just a little bit and, you know, step out where it's not safe. You might need to leave the safe place and go somewhere that God is asking you to go, if you will, or do something that he's asking you to do. Be courageous. Get off the bench and get into the game, so to speak, whatever that might be. But we have this armor bearer. And this is what we miss sight of. He's not named, but he's very important. I mean, really important. I mean, Jonathan doesn't win this battle without that armor bearer. Israel does not win this battle without the armor bearer. He's very, very important, but yet he's not named. He's a servant. He's young, the Bible says. I submit to you, Jonathan came up with a very courageous plan to do something for God. Something that many would say would be impossible. Let's go fight. Just you and me.
The two of us. Let's go do that.
But what he needed was someone else. He needed to partner, if you will, with somebody else that had courage. So I think it's important to recognize that you want to win some spiritual battles courageously. You got to recognize you have to partner with other people that are courageous. It is contagious. I love sports. I was very, very athletic and very good at basketball. I played football. I played baseball. Now, one preacher said, you know, when you talk about how good you were in high school, the older you get, the better you were in high school. Isn't that true? How many of you are really good in high school, huh? Yeah. But one of the things I love about playing in team sports is that courage, that bond, that, hey, you got another person that's partnering with you. You're going to battle together, if you will. And it is nothing like it. That teamwork and that partnership and that whatever you're doing it together. And we got to do that. You see, Jonathan here came up with a very courageous plan. Some would say not very smart. But notice this armor bearer. He partnered. Jonathan knew I needed someone else to partner with me. And he says, I am with thee according to thy heart. Now, this armor bearer could have said, yeah, can we talk about this for just a moment? Now, Jonathan, I know you kind of want to go up there. You're tired of sitting. But there's just two of us. There's just two of us. And there's a lot of them. And we're just two. This is a lot. He could have begun listing all the reasons why. Jonathan, you're crazy. You loco. You dumb. This would never work. He could have done that. But his armor bearer was courageous also. He was willing. He saw the potential. You see, those people that are courageous, you know what they do? They see potential. You got to see potential. Hey, why don't you live on the aisle of, hey, I'm going to be courageous and I'm going to see some potential in what we're going to do. Cowards, you know what cowards do? They always see the problem. But we only have two swords. We only have two swords. That's the problem. And where was the coward in this regard? Where was King Saul with the other sword? Was he there ready to battle? No, he was sitting under a pomegranate tree. Probably the sword was leaning up against a tree, not doing anything, and waiting. Partner with some other people of courage. We see in the Bible partnerships, God used that quite a bit. Moses and Aaron. Partnerships. Joshua and Caleb. Paul and Barnabas. Paul and Silas. Paul and Timothy. Jesus sent his disciples out two by two. Paul told Timothy to, hey, be around those people and go and do others also and teach others also. Ecclesiastes tells us that two are better than one. Hey, I wrote this down here. Don't discount the importance of other people. Don't discount it. Are you courageous? You're striving to be? Don't discount the fact that you're probably going to need to partner up with someone else that's courageous and going to do different things. This is why it's important that we have people that work together. Work together. Minister together. Work together. This is why some of the greatest marriages on planet Earth are when the husband and the wife, yes, I said it, the husband and the wife, they work together. They partner together. They have a common goal. They're courageous. You say, what's so courageous about being married? Well, if you're married, you know. Then the kids come. Then you're really courageous. I've got four beautiful children, beautiful daughters, amen. Courageous. I always told everybody, there's a lot of crying in my household. I always would say that. They're getting older. Now there's just dirty looks. You know, hey. Now, we're in our text here, chapter 14. Jonathan comes up with a plan. And the plan wasn't that great. And notice the plan here in verse 12, I think it is. The plan was in verse 10, 11, and 12. He says, if they call us up and say, hey, you come on up. That's God telling us we're going to win this thing. If they say, no, you stay there. Okay, that means that we're just going to stay right where we're at. Look at verse 12. And the men of the garrison answered Jonathan and his armor bearer and said, come up to us and we will show you a thing. And Jonathan said to his armor, come up after me, for the Lord had delivered them into the hand of Israel. He didn't have the high ground, by the way. You know, that is an art of war. Hey, make sure you have the high ground. That's pretty important. But here, if you have the Lord, you have the high ground. Verse 13, and Jonathan climbed up on his hands and upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him, and they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew after him. I can just imagine it in my mind. They're going up this rocky, he's got a sword in his hand, he's climbing up, and they're fighting him, and he's killing them, and slaying them, and laying them back as he continues to go forward, and his armor bearer is finishing the job. I mean, they're working together. Hey, I stuck him in the heart, you finish him out. And the Bible says they got a victory here. 20 men, I think it says here. Look at verse number 14. And that first slaughter with Jonathan, his armor bearer, made was about 20 men. Now notice there, I underlined that at the first slaughter. Now what happens when you say first? Is there another? Typically there is. So we're not told about it, but this was the first slaughter. This is the time. At this time, there was 20 of them, and he slaughtered them, and it gives us an acreage and all that right here. Now, what did all of this courage do? It inspired the people. In verse 15, it says, and there was trembling in the host of the field, and among the people, the garrison and the spoilers, they also trembled. And the earthquake, so it was a very great trembling. So what's happening here? Jonathan goes up between these two sharp places. He says, you know what? I'm ready to go. Are you with me? He goes out courageously and begins his battle. There's 30,000 Philistines all around Gibeah. 30,000. And they go to this garrison and they wipe it out. news gets back to the other garrisons and the other companies of the Philistines' army, and they say, "What's going on here? What's happening?" And God brings an earthquake. And they're just so disoriented. They don't know what's going on. And God uses that. And then what happens is that all the Israelites, the Jewish people that were afraid, they're hiding in the rocks, they're hiding in the caves. Guess what they do when they hear the noise of the earthquake, when they hear the shout of Israel's army? They go out and they start to battle and they start to win. And guess what? We know what happens at the end of all of it. Verse 23 of chapter 14. So the Lord saved Israel that day, and there was a slaughter and a victory, and there was some winning going on there. Listen, I want some wins in my life. I like to win. This is why game nights in my house are difficult at times, because I'm very competitive. So this is why sometimes I say I can't play that game with you, because I'll want to throw the dice at you. And so I want to be a good example. So I can't play with you because I'll get angry. But I like to win. But sometimes what we do is we just sit on the sidelines like Saul, sit around. It's time for us to get out of our comfort zone. It's time for us to partner up with other people of courage. And then, how many swords were there in Israel at this time?
Two.
Here it is, the last thing. Fight with what God has given you. So often we think about what we don't have. We don't have money. Welcome to the world. You say, he's got more than me. Yeah, but you both say, I don't have enough. We are so focused on what we don't have. Maybe we should focus on what we do have. You remember? There are two swords in all of Israel. Jonathan had a sword. King Saul had a sword. Saul sat underneath the tree. Jonathan took that sword and he went up and he won a great victory. You see the contrast? And the same thing happens today. You and I are believers in the Lord, and we have the Spirit of God within us, and we have the Word of God, and we have the spiritual gifts that God has given us. And let me encourage you, it's our time to use what God has given us. It's time. We have access to the same opportunities to know God's word, don't we? Take those tools, use them for his honor and glory, win some great victories, see people's lives change and impacted. What was Saul doing? He was sitting in the pew. Other people were battling. He was sitting in the pew. So what are you trying to tell me? Is this me? I don't know. But maybe you're just in a comfortable place and it's time for you to step out and do some ministry. Talk to that neighbor. Talk to that friend, that family member. To be courageous and say, you know what? I believe God can do the impossible. God can use me. You say, well, I don't have anything to offer. I'm older. I don't have anything to offer. You got it all wrong. All wrong. I'm not as old as you, but I can already tell. There's some people coming up after us, and they're messing this place up big time. And I've done it too. So you got a lot of wisdom. You can help. We need it. It's time for you to stand up. Be faithful. It'll inspire others. Partner with other people that are courageous. Be an encouragement. Oh, for so many years, I was an armor bearer. For so many years. Maybe that's what God's calling you to do. Just be that armor bearer. Yeah, you may not have the plan that God gave you in your heart, but you know what? You're faithful. You're like, I'm with you. I'm going God's direction. This is of God. I'm going to be courageous. I'm going to follow. And you know what? Yeah, I might not be the first in line, but I can slay after you, and I can do a part, and I can be a part of it, and I can be an encouragement. You know what? One of the greatest things about our church here is that we are filled with people that love to encourage other people. Man, we live in a depressing world, do we not? I mean, listen, I'm going to encourage you. Just turn off the news. Shut your phone off for a day or two. You might feel a little better. You might just say, oh, it's got a blue sky out here today. Maybe you think a little less about China, a little less about the president, a little less about this, a little less about that. And maybe you say, man, isn't that amazing what God created, how the sun comes up every day? Except for when it rains, right? We had quite a bit of that, haven't we? But maybe it's time to get a little perspective. What has God given you? We got servants all over the place in our church. Little gifts, little talents. Little things that you're doing. I appreciate that. You're a blessing to this preacher, that's for sure. You are. Now let me show you a verse here and then we're done. Look at Ephesians chapter 6. You were kind of over there a little bit. Look at verse 13. Now, if you're a Christian, you've been given tools, you've been given weapons to fight. And not a physical fight, but a spiritual one. And our job is to take those and use them for His honor and glory, win some victories, love people. But look what it says in verse 13. Wherefore, take upon you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in that evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore. Now look at me at verse number 17 now. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the, what is that? Word of God. So yeah, we have not been given, if you will, a physical sword, but we've been given a spiritual sword. And yeah, I know there might not be that many around that care about this sword, amen? And it might be limited, and you know what? You might have a hard time finding one on a bookshelf or on a coffee table or a bedside stand. I get that, but you're going to see it here, and we have one, amen? We have the Word of God, and it is the sword of the Spirit, and we're going to use it. Maybe it's time for you to get into here. See what God has for you. Maybe it's time for you to say, wait a minute, I'm kind of weak right now. I need some power. I need some direction. I need a little an arrow for me. Get into the Word of God. Rightly divide it. See what God has for you. Listen, we are in a wrestling match. And we need the sword of the Spirit. What are you doing with your sword? What was Saul doing? What was Jonathan doing? Two swords in all of the land. Is it just there, next to you, waiting for something? Or is it like Jonathan's where you're using it, you're sharpening it, you're using it to its full potential. You're doing what God is at. You're being courageous with it. Be courageous. Fight, if you will, these spiritual battles with fear, with faith, if you will. Don't be a coward and live in fear. Win these spiritual battles by relying upon what the sword of the Spirit has given you, the Word of God. Listen, we live in a place where truth is sometimes nowhere to be found, but we have the sword of the Spirit here. We have the Word of God. Let me encourage you. Let's use what God has given us. And by the way, if you know me, you know me at all. I recognize God has created all sorts of different people. Amen. Different gifts, different abilities, different things. And so guess what? There's no cookie cutters with the Lord. I'm glad about that. Because I don't think I would have fit in one of those, personally. So I'm glad he's still able to use me and give me certain things to do and certain gifts and abilities. And he's done that for you. Find your place to serve. Go out courageously and says, I'll say yes. Has there been something that you've been afraid about? Afraid about talking about this or talking to that person or helping that or doing a ministry or meeting a need or be courageous. Be courageous. Trust God. Step out of that comfort zone. Partner with somebody who's courageous. And use the weapon that God has given us. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we love you. And Lord, I'm just so mindful of how encouraging this was to me as a pastor. And Lord, I hope that wasn't lost on our folks today. We just ask, Lord, that you do your will. Have your will. Lord, we struggle. Our hands are faint. Our bodies are weak. And we just ask you, Lord, for that spiritual courage that we need to win these spiritual battles. Lord, we're so weak in the flesh. Lord, help us to step out on faith, to do those things that others would say are just simply impossible. But Lord, but we know that all things are possible with you. Help us to step out of our comfort zone, that place of safety where it's all warm and cuddly and we're just so used to it. Help us to step out courageously so that we can do your work and bring you honor and glory. Lord, help us to find people in our lives that are courageously trusting in you. Help us to partner with them so that we can do great things for you, Lord. Lord, help us to be mindful that you've given us a sword, not just to set it up next to a tree, but help us to use it. Help us to sharpen it. Help us to do battles, spiritual battles for you. Lord, we just love you today. We know that you're dealing with hearts. We ask that you do your will and your way. We pray this in your name. Let's stand together, a spirit of prayer. The instruments are going to go ahead and start to play. This altar is available for you. Maybe the Lord has spoken to you about something. Maybe you just need to be right where you're at in your seat. Has the Lord spoken to you? Maybe today's a great day and you say, you know what, Pastor, I don't know that if I die today, I go to heaven. I just don't know that. I'm struggling right now, but I'd like to know for sure that if I were to die, go out into eternity, that I would know Him as my Savior. Maybe that's you. I want to invite you. Today's a great day to know Jesus as your Savior. Maybe it's time for you to step out of a comfort zone. Maybe this weekend of ministry is an opportunity for you to talk to somebody. Share your life. Be courageous. Partner up with someone. Maybe it's time for you to use the sword, use the weapon that God has put in your hand to fight some spiritual battles instead of going to the bottle, instead of going to the world, instead of going to all sorts of things that people, let's go to God and let God win our battles for us. And just one quick stanza she's playing through. I appreciate your attention, your kind attention to God's word. Jonathan was an amazing man, humble man if you look at his life. He was willing to give up what many would thought would be his right to the heir. He was willing to give that up because he loved God. God was in his heart. And he wanted to do these gracious things for the Lord. Let me encourage you, meditate upon these truths. Meditate upon that passage. Ask the Lord, is there anything in my life that I need to be more courageous about? Ask the Lord about that this week. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll be dismissed, okay? Lord, we love you. Thank you for your people. Thank you for taking care of us and meeting our needs. Thank you, Lord, that you courageously went to the cross. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us the power to be courageous in you and trust in you. Help us step out of ourselves and this safe places that we create in our life and go out there and win some spiritual victories for you. Lord, be with our marriages, be with our families, be with our ministries here. May you do all of these things for your honor and glory. Help us to bring praise and honor and glory to you. That's our desire. And we pray this and all God's people said, amen. God bless you, folks. You are dismissed.